Hello and welcome to Campus Chat. My name is Helene Morris and this is the show about Western Nevada College. It's our last show. Donald, this is my guest, Don Hummer. He's the current chairman of the Western Nevada College Foundation Board. He's been a loyal supporter of the college since 1998 and he feels like the captain on the Titanic, he told me earlier. But we're going to be talking about the budget crisis affecting the Nevada system of higher education, and in particular, Western Nevada College. And we're also very pleased to have three alum with us today, and we'll be talking about what a difference Western Nevada College made in their life. And we'll be taking two breaks and giving you a list of our local legislators. We'd like you to contact them and let them know that WNC is important to the state and that you'd like to see us be here. But it's kind of hard to believe. You know, we did our first show 10 years ago. I remember we were building the observatory. Buzz Aldrin was here. It was the first year of our Peace Officer Academy. I mean, it's a lot different than now, and I'm kind of saddened because it looks like all of the things the foundation has worked for.
Well, the foundation, the college, right. I mean, everything that's happened that's been great for this college over the last 10, 15 years potentially could be undone here in the next couple of months. And it's really scary.
It is scary, and it's not calling wolf or anything like that. When you look at some of the steps that we're going to have to take to absorb these cuts, we will be closing rural campuses and eliminating programs. That's just all there is to it.
And, you know, those things just won't come back. I mean, it's really scary to think about what the governor and the legislature is thinking about doing with Nevada education. I mean, right now we already have the lowest per capita spending on education in the United States, including Puerto Rico. You know, K to 12, the governor's proposing $270 less per student, and we already fund at $2,000 less per student than any other state in the union. I mean, you know, I look at education all the way from K to 12 through higher education with Western Nevada College, universities. We need to have a strong program all the way through. if we don't do this and we start doing what they're talking about, I mean, our crime rate's going to go up. I mean, it's been shown time and time again on many studies that crime rate goes up in proportion to education spending going down.
Absolutely, because if you have an educated populace, not only they're socially, culturally, economically, I mean, there's a whole list of factors that educated people, I mean, there are some educated wackos out there, don't get me wrong, but overall, the majority of people, once they get that background, they're better citizens.
I mean, it provides an opportunity for them to succeed that they won't have if they don't have a good education. I mean, a couple things that Nevada does lead in is that we have the highest per capita minimum wage jobs. You know, that's not one we want to keep have the trophy for. You know, Governor Sandoval's campaign message spoke of education as a cornerstone of helping Nevada out of the recession. Yet these huge slashes are proposing are just opposite. I mean, that's going to just destroy education.
And there's already talk of huge companies that have come to Nevada and have left because the educated workforce isn't here.
Yeah, that's one of the weakest things. You know, Nevada is a very business-friendly in terms of regulation, but it ranks like 48th, I believe, with regard to opportunities for businesses because we do not have a strong educated workforce. They just don't have the people to hire.
Right. You know, I was wondering, in the governor's State of the State, he did say that he was only going to cut higher education by 17.6%, but I'm here to tell you that was a disingenuous message, because in actuality, the cuts to Western are 31.7%. What they failed to do was count the stimulus money that they used to fill the hole in the last cycle of budgeting, and they didn't replace that. So if you look at the state funds, yeah, it's only a 17% cut for state funds, but they neglected to add in for us the $8 million in stimulus funds that we got, which was always part of our general fund budget. And I'm thinking disingenuous at best, and it doesn't help economic development.
It's almost criminal. I mean, yeah, to be perfectly honest with you, we're not talking about cutting one or two classes. We're talking about cutting whole programs that, you know, the students in the rural areas count on that would not be able to get a higher education. Programs here, I mean, you're talking, you know, things that they've tried to develop over the last 10 years that can be undone and will most likely never come back if they
do
this.
Right. Well, you know, we're looking at Western Nevada. They're talking a lot about reform also at the legislature. And like reform is a new word to us. Well, under Dr. Lucy, we've had two strategic plans that have worked on access and success of students. And in the past 10 years, our capture rate, it's a term we use, capture rate of high school graduates in 1999 was 15%. Now in 2010, 10 years later, or 11, I was never good at math. Anyway, you know what I'm, the capture rate, 30% of area high school students now attend Western Nevada College. And before that, once again, lowest in the nation for those types of numbers. We need to those high school students to get into college. And it doesn't have to be a college degree. It can be a certificate.
Yeah. Associate's degree. I mean, but the more education they get, the higher probability they're going to have great opportunities for success in the future. And it's going to bring in more businesses. I mean, businesses really want to see, you know, people that have been trained, that have learned their area, that have the technical and scientific skills to be able to handle the jobs.
Now, you wrote a great article in this issue of In Touch, which is our donor and alumni newsletter. I loved your I loved how you addressed the real problem, which is the lack of revenue.
Yeah. I mean, frankly, you know, gaming revenue has been down since 2006, and it's had a steadily increasing decline. It's not coming back. I mean, and they're still talking, trying to rely on this type of revenue. And, you know, gaming's available now in every state in the union. You know, we don't have a monopoly on that. You know, we'll always have some gaming revenue, but it's gone. And they've got to understand, we're not talking, you know, what I think we need to do is find new revenue. You know, people will say the word tax or something like that. It's not additional tax. It's not additional revenue. It's replacement revenue for what's happened in the gaming industry. And, you know, they've talked about, you know, the governor and the senator and our state, or even Harry Reid, always talk about making Nevada this green mecca for geothermal and wind and sun. You know, we can't do that without having an education infrastructure in this state to have the people there to run these industries. You know, we have, you know, luckily enough in Nevada, we do have wind. We do have a lot of sun. We've got a lot of open land. We've got geothermal. But so do states like Arizona and New Mexico and Texas and Utah. And the only way for us to snag those jobs and the future of this state is to build up education, not cut it back, to build it up right now, put more money into it, make it stronger. So when businesses say, where do I want to locate my next wind farm or my next solar plant? I want to look at Nevada because they're going to be producing the types of employees that I want to have hired.
Now, if I didn't know you better, I'd say you were a tax and spend liberal.
You know, that's the last thing I am.
I know.
I'm very conservative, fiscally conservative. I hate the idea of taxes, of what's going on in California and that kind of stuff, and wasting money. But the fact of the matter is, we cannot grow this state unless we get some new revenue now to support those education, namely, so that we can get these jobs in the future. That's going to be our future. It's not going to be gaming. You know, it's not going to be mining. It's not going to be anything else. What this state has is the ability to be a green state and provide those technologies, but we have to have the residents and the people here that will attract the business to build, because they can build any place.
Yeah, I like give us your analogy of when you run out of food. I love that.
You know, I was putting some stuff down. You know, if a person goes hungry and his food is dried up, he goes out and finds a new source of food. He doesn't start cutting off appendages to try to save energy. I mean, we do that, your demise is quick. And that's exactly what the state's talking about here with the way they're cutting programs. Those programs won't come back. That education, you know, people will start leaving the state. They will look for other places or opportunities, and if we don't have them here.
Yeah, exactly. I really appreciate that, what you're saying, and I also appreciate your commitment to the K-12 education system. You've always been a strong proponent of the entire system, because if they can't read or write when they come to college, and some of them can't, we have a huge remedial issue, but you're right, the entire system of education needs to be supported.
It has to be fully funded. You know, history can teach us a lot about what's happened. In the 1800s, Nevada went through its mining bust. And for 50 years, till 1931, this state just languished. 600 cities and towns vanished. Tens of thousands of people left the state. It got so bad that there was even talk in Washington at the time of revoking our statehood because basically it was just this big empty vastness here. You know, I'm not saying it's that bad, but I'm hoping that the governor and legislators don't take 50 years to figure out that we need to get some new revenue now. We need to fully fund the schools and education so that we can do our next big thing, which I think will be in solar and wind and geothermal, because we have the ability to do that here. But we have to be competitive to get those jobs and get those industries, and the only way to do that is going to be through education.
Well, that, well said. We've run out of time. That went fast, didn't it?
It did. It went very fast.
You know, you've been a great chair. It's been a pleasure working with you.
It's been my pleasure. I'm kind of sad that this is the last show. I've been on this a couple of times. I think it's a great thing for the college. And I'm just hoping the legislature is listening and the governor's listening. You've got to do the right thing here. Don't tell us what we want to hear. Tell us the truth. Find some additional revenue and fund education, K-12 through higher education and universities.
Couldn't have said it any better. Stay with us. We'll be right back with Campus Chat. Welcome back to our last Campus Chat. I'm kind of sad to say it. My name is Helene Morris, and it's our 10th and final year, and during the breaks you'll be seeing the names of our legislators. We'll hope you'll contact them and just ask them to save higher education. And I really mean that, save higher education. Western Nevada College has made a difference to thousands of graduates in its 40-year history. We're celebrating 40 years, 2011. And I'm really pleased that the rest of our show, we have various alum with us today. Sitting right next to me is Michelle Ford. She is a machinist. You got an AAS in machine tool technology?
Yes, I did.
Yeah, welcome, Michelle.
Thank
and then
you.
Sitting next to Michelle is Detective Daniel Gonzalez. He graduated from our Western Nevada Peace Officer Academy. You met your wife there?
Yes.
Now you have three children?
I do.
Yes, that's amazing. Yeah, we're on our best behavior with Daniel here. Because you never know, you might say something, you know, that he might file for later use, like, oh, I'm going to check on her. But no, really, it's nice to have you here, really nice.
Thank you.
So, machine tool technology, when did you graduate from our program?
I graduated in May of last year, 2010.
Now, that's, were you the only woman in the program, or?
No, I know of a few other women in the program. I don't know that they've graduated yet. But there's a few.
Yeah, so because usually that's it's been a male-dominated. I bet you're pretty good with your tolerances, though, right?
I am very good with tolerance.
But, you know, tolerance is not of male students, but of in machining to, that's what I meant.
Yes, yeah.
That was pretty good, though. I didn't realize
that. Detail-oriented.
Yeah, exactly. So what led you to that career?
Well, I was working in the electronics manufacturing industry, and I was making a pretty low wage, working long hours just to get by, and one day I heard how much a CNC programmer makes. And I was basically doing the same kind of job, programming a machine, and I thought, there's no reason why I can't do better. Mm-hmm. And so I enrolled in college.
Yeah,
in
that's
classes.
Great. And Daniel, when did you graduate from the Peace Officer Academy?
I graduated in 2003.
And why did you decide to enter into law enforcement?
I was in the retail business prior to that, and I always liked helping people. So what more, in the fire department or police department, they all help people, so I thought that would be a great career to go into.
And did you get a job right away coming out of the...
I was very fortunate in 2003. I was able to get a job right away, correct, here in Carson City.
Oh, that's great. And we're working forward to... Ken Furlong hire you?
He did. He actually was a sheriff at the time, and he did hire me.
So did you start off?